up? I'm Erin, Dr. Shred Deathridge, and you are tuning in to one of the best programs in the business. It's Hard Tales with Dave Cohen. Take it away, Dave.
And welcome to Guitar Tales. I can't do it like Erin. She has a I look fake when I'm doing it. Now she does it very organically. But Erin Deathridge, thank you so much for that bumper. That was a great one. We also want to thank, as we've been doing for the past probably four or five episodes, our sponsor, Charles Larita of Mischief Studios. He was a guest on season one. Phenomenal guitar player, great songwriter. And if you have any kind of recording need, if you need to buy a guitar, if you need to fix a guitar, if you need to hook up with musicians, give Charles a call. He will hook you up with musicians. He'll teach you how to play better, help you write songs, and he has studio space right in his great building in Pennington, New Jersey. So reach out to him. And as I say every episode, and I mean it every episode, I want to thank my dear friend Scott Guitarmacist Engel. We are looking at him, Liz and I, that's your foreshadowing as to who our guest is today. Liz and I are looking at Scott, but he's in black and white in the corner of our screen right now. He's giving us the thumbs up, but no one can see it but us. But Scott's the mastermind behind not only what you see with the show, but really getting what we hope to be better and better content each time we tape an episode out there, whether it is a full episode, whether Scott is taking the time to turn it into a reel, which is no small amount of work. Getting it across all platforms. We are on YouTube. We're on Facebook. We are on Audible. And Scott could write me on chats. There's more. We're also going to be doing, just Scott and I, separate shows, which we're really excited about. We'll be doing mini episodes talking about things that you would like us to talk about. So if you have any ideas that you would like to hear Scott and I chat about, shoot us a note through any form of social media that we're on, and we won't do it. No, we will. But now I'm really excited. We are probably, I'm going to guess, our fourth youngest guest ever. I was at the Stone Pony about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I watched Girlbossanova, a great new band with a great vibe, great songs, great musicianship. And I asked their lead guitarist if she'd come on our show, Liz Roberts. And in about 4 seconds, you'll see her on the screen. Hey, Liz, thanks for joining us.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
Well, we're thrilled to have you. And I got to tell you, I was thrilled when you said yes after the show. So thank you.
Yeah, I've been looking forward to this all week. I could talk about this band and music for like hours.
That's so good.
This is something I was just super excited for.
Well, and as you should be. And one of the things that Scott and I really like when we get a young guest like you, it is that, you know, literally in the 1970s, Pete Townsend was singing Rock is Dead, you know, and he was, you know, predicting something that to some extent has partially occurred. You know, if when Scott and I were growing up, rock was this much of the music scene, right? Mm-hmm. It got smaller and smaller. Now it's strong, but it's this, you know,
right? Yeah.
And people our age, you know, we're both almost 40 now. People our age really can't hold the mantle of rock and roll. So when we see someone young who is, in my words, but I think you'll agree, authentically, you know, carrying the mantle, we're really happy to get to chat with you and more happy that you're doing what you do.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's a really interesting point. And I could talk about that for so long. It is really, I guess, like difficult to be into that kind of music just as a young person, because I mean, obviously it's not popular. It's not what's popular. But there is something to be said about like resurgence of rock.
Do you feel that? Do you feel?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've talked about it with my friends before, because I know people who think, oh, rock is, you know, dead. It's never going to be mainstream again. It's always going to be other kinds of music. Like right now, hip hop, I think, is probably what's the most mainstream, or just like pop, like,
right.
But then you think of how there was rock, but then there was like all the disco synth stuff back in the 70s, and there's rock again kind of in the 80s with like glam rock, a new kind of rock. And then in the 90s when grunge came out and all this new kinds of rock, it was rock music. It was just not the same as it was in the 70s. And to people who say like that's never going to happen again, that's not true, because as a young person who's in like the music scene, even if it is just the local one, you see so many bands and so many people, so many creative people with these ideas that are just like continuing rock music in their own way.
Right.
And I don't think it's ever going to be like dead. I think people are going to keep continuing it, and it's going to keep having these like resurgences just with kind of different genres. But even then, it's also like you see so many people my age. I think what actually dominates our like local scene is like these classic rock bands who do mainly covers, but I've also seen so many doing original stuff too that fits into like it sounds like classic rock. It sounds like came right out of the 70s, and there's so much of that, which is so cool. And I don't think it's going to be like mainstream again, I guess, but I don't think it's ever gonna die.
Well, so is there something for you? You could like, I'm talking in front of a laptop right now. Mm-hmm. And if you have a really good Apple, right, you could create music without anything ever entering the air, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, you know, for someone your age, you know, you're young enough where you grew up, you know, with an iPad and then an iPhone and you know, I'm guessing you're about 21, 22 years old, something like that.
20.
There you go. So I know my kids are 20 and 22. And by the time they were 4 and 5, you know, they've got screens, right? All the time. And you are accustomed to being on devices with screens. And yet you're drawn to music that enters the air before it gets recorded, you know. It's going from your guitar through a cord into an amp and out a speaker, which is literally pushing air. The speaker is bouncing back and forth and pushing air. And one of my fears would be that kids your age would be so much more attracted to everything on their little screen and their virtual keyboard and all that. And I wonder what drew you to what I know I'm more partial to, and I know Scott is more partial to, is the grittiness. Your fingers are touching the screen, the strings. You have an amp, maybe you have a tube amp, maybe you have a solid state, but or a modeling amp. But what is it about that kind of formation of music and art where you're way outside of a screen that drew you to it?
I think there's, think of it in like a broader sense. I think there's always going to be an interest in doing stuff how it was done originally, like even if it's just like a niche, you see it everywhere. Like you see it in photography. Like my sister likes to take photos using film, and there's just always going to be like the desire, I guess, to go back to where something started and do that no matter how far we come with technology. Because like you said, even though I can just go on my computer and put what chord I want to make and have it feed it back to me, like I could do that, anyone could do that. And with technology and everything and AI just getting to be so crazy.
It is, yeah.
I guess what really drew me to it was just the satisfaction of picking up a skill and just being able to do it as the people I look up to did it. Like when I first started getting into like rock music, I guess, or subgenre of it, I must have been 11 or 12.
Okay.
And I started listening to stuff other than what was like just on the radio and like stuff my dad plays for me. I started listening to like pop punk stuff. Like that was my big thing, as a lot of people do in middle school.
Oh, really? Now, what is pop punk?
I guess I would define it as just, I don't really know how to define it, but just to give examples, bands like Fall Out Boy, like My Chemical Romance, Pin of the Disco, Third Eye Blind. It's kind of like Green Day. Green Day, I think they were the ones who kind of created it.
Right, because they're, you know, You know, actually, my history with Scott is that he took me away from a punk band and we joined a band together or created a band together.
Cool.
But the punk from late 70s, early 80s is very different from Green Day because Green Day is really listenable. You know, they have real structure to their songs. They're produced nicely. But they still found a way to sort of capture a big piece of the edge of those punk bands. Like, you know, the Pistols, they were once in a while listenable, but they're very much not listenable to some people.
Yeah.
Like so that's really what you're talking about with that pop punk?
Yeah. Yeah. So it's basically just taking punk and then making it like pop, you know, making it more accessible.
Hooks and melody and things like that.
Exactly. And that's kind of where it all started. And I think the biggest band that had an influence on me at that time was My Chemical Romance. I started playing guitar because of them.
All right.
And I still, they're like so close to my heart. I will never dislike them. I will never like cringe at the fact I was such a big fan, because I'm still a huge fan. I'm never not be a fan. But they're why I kind of started playing guitar, because I just saw, I saw that's how they were doing it. And I was like, I want to do that. I want to make music like that. I want to be able to play guitar just like Frank Iero does. Like, I want his guitar. My first electric guitar was the same model.
Oh, really? What was it?
As one that he has. It was an Epiphone Wilshire.
Okay.
Not very expensive, not very fancy. Not even the best sounding instrument. no offense.
But that's okay, right?
But that's okay, and that's how I wanted it to be. I didn't want anything fancy. I remember my dad saying, like, wow, you don't want, like, you know, a nice Fender, maybe? And I was like, no, this is exactly what I want, because I want to do what he does, and I want to sound like him. And that's kind of how it all started, and I just fell in love with picking up the skill and slowly getting better and being able to change chords faster. And I just really fell in love with it. I just thought, like, if I ever end up making music, it's going to be through this skill and with the guitar. I didn't really see it any other way.
Well, that's really great. And now, were you more of a lesson or a self-taught kind of person?
I started taking lessons, actually, because my sister, it's funny, she's the one who took guitar lessons first. And I started doing it kind of soon after she did, maybe a few months. And she actually ended up quitting. Because she just, I guess, wasn't really that into it. So then I started at the same place, this place called The Music Place in Siegert. And okay. I took lessons there from when I was 12 to when I was 19. So that's a fair amount. It's a very long time. And the guitar teacher I had, his name is Matt King, probably one of my biggest inspirations just in life, like top five favorite people of all time. He is just so incredibly knowledgeable, just gave the best advice when it comes to musicianship, and even just advice about life in general. Like, he was just so amazing, and he would do whatever you wanted to do. So if you just wanted to learn a song, he could teach you the song. If you wanted to really, really get into theory and work on your technique and take it really seriously, he could do that. And we did do that for a little while. And just an amazing, amazing teacher, like one of the best teachers I've ever had in my life. And I think if I really, really wanted to, I could have taken it a lot more seriously, but I kind of just wanted to keep it as like a fun little hobby and continue going to lessons just to learn more technique and learn maybe some songwriting tips and stuff like that. Those lessons were so amazing, and I owe all my skill to him, really.
A little bit to you maybe too, right?
Some to me.
Yeah, maybe a little bit to you. You know, and it's interesting, you know, when you talk about life's lessons too. You know, you're on this musical journey. It's an artistic journey. It's a self-discovery journey. So it really makes a lot of sense that the person who's your tour guide on that mm-hmm. journey is the person who will give you life's lessons too. Because everything you're learning on guitar applies to life. you know.
Exactly. And
one thing you said resonated with me. You know, in the town that I grew up in Mattawan, not that far away, it seemed like every single person played guitar, at least every, for my generation, every boy played guitar. And a lot of the people who took it a little too seriously at too young an age gave up on it. And I think the people who found sort of the healthy balance between the rest of life and that, maybe those people didn't become the best musicians in the world, but they stayed with it and they were allowed, they allowed themselves to grow at a reasonable pace and they made it a marathon, not a sprint. And it sounds like that's what you're doing.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. I used to get down on myself, like, wow, I am really not that great of a technical player. Like, I don't know that much about theory and all this, because when you are in like the local music scene, you just see such incredible, incredible people. And you're like, oh my God. And people younger than me, you know, people my age. And you're like, wow, you know, it's so easy to get down yourself. But then I think like, I prefer it so much the way I'm doing it. Like, because I am pretty comfortable with my skill because it allows me to write the music I want to write, play the music I want to play. And I'm very happy with it. But that being said, like, obviously there's always room for improvement, but I'm going to improve at whatever rate I want to, you know, because if you do put that kind of pressure on yourself, it is so easy to just give up because it's just too difficult. Like, sorry, I always want to think of music as something I love and a hobby I can enjoy and not get frustrated and upset by. So yeah, I just kind of am doing it at my own pace. Still That's looking healthy. To improve for sure, but I just want to keep it as something that's relaxing and something that it brings me joy.
That it could not be a healthier statement. And you said something else that I both observed and intrigued me. So when I went over, there were a bunch of bands playing at the Stone Pony. It's about a month ago, maybe 3 weeks ago, I was there and I saw your band. I was so happy to see flooding into the bar. Some people weren't allowed to drink. They were that young. But young people who had, I'm talking about in the audience as opposed to your band, but rock people who were clearly under 25, let's say, who looked like they had rock sensibility about them and part of rock culture, if you will. I don't know anything about that Asbury Park scene for young folk like you. What is it like? Vibrant? Do you all know each other? I guess social media plays a role in how you connect, but tell us a little bit about that scene, that iconic Asbury, because Asbury Park goes back 50 years really with the music scene. What is it like now for young people like you?
So that's a really interesting question. So just to give some context, the two of the girls in my band, my best friend is our singer, Erin, and her sister, Emma, they were also in a band in high school called Flourish. And when they were in Flourish, like, they were playing shows all the time, you know, in Asbury and surrounding area, almost every single weekend one summer, they were playing shows. And so it's funny because I would always go to those shows, and it's funny to see how some bands are always going to stick around. Like, we've seen the same bands like just a ton of times, and maybe even the same people in different bands, and it's all just kind of interconnected, and people will recognize them from that band. And it's just like, there's just always some kind of connection somewhere. And because I guess since it isn't really very big, like, it is kind of small, kind of like a small scene, I guess. Because there aren't really, at least from my like high school, I know there were not really that many people doing music. So when there are people who do it, like, you see them come up like all the time. And the scene is, it's interesting because you have so many different genres, and it's just interesting to see I guess, like, how do I put this? Like, just seeing where everyone takes it. And social media does play a really, really huge part in it, because a lot of what happens is you go to a show that you're playing and you post a picture.
Who's
video.
That on that picture?
I love that picture. That was a really good one by Jeff Crespi. What was I saying? Oh yeah, you post a picture or video of like one of the bands you're seeing and they'll respond to it. And then you have a relationship already. It's that
right,
easy.
Right.
It's that quick. It's that fast. And then you just kind of have like mental tabs on that person. They said I was cool, so we're going to keep them in mind. Then you end up playing shows together again and again and again, and they introduce you to other people, and then you just get more and more in the scene. So I guess it is kind of easy to network when it comes to like social media and all that. And everyone that I've noticed, everyone is just so supportive of each other, which is really, really amazing. Like I've noticed within my age group and people we play shows with and everything, it's just everybody is so sweet and everybody wants their name out, wants other people to feel good about what they're doing. It's just, it's a really, really good scene, I think.
Really mutually supportive.
Yes, exactly.
And that picture, Scott, can you put that picture up again? That last one, I love that picture. So, yeah, and you know what? This is, you know, you can see a little bit in the background, it says Stone Pony. Scott has played the Stone Pony. We've had a few other people on the show who've played there. That's an internationally known venue. I mean, you know, in the conversation, I've talked with people about it. You've got the Stone Pony, CBGB's, the Whiskey A Go Go. Those are sort of the biggies that I could think of off the top of my head. And that you had, before you're even old enough to drink, you've had the honor of playing there. I think that was your second time there, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And that's gigantic. And that picture, it really does capture the scene. I actually am embarrassed to say that I had not been in the Stone Pony in about 30 years.
Oh, wow.
I was at whatever the previous iteration of the Rat, that, you know, the radio station. Mm-hmm. They had some kind of radio party there, you know, for their station. And I was there. And that was the last time when radio actually mattered.
Oh, wow.
And not serious, but you know, terrestrial radio, as we call it. But you walk into the Stone Pony and the vibe there is so transporting. And what I like about it is that it's not just a very rock and roll vibe, but it's a very Jersey Shore rock and roll vibe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's hard to describe, but it just has that feel about it. And I wonder, when you get up there on stage, are you just feeling rock and roll, or are you feeling the Stone Pony on some level?
I think there's like absolutely no feeling compared to playing live music, but playing live music on a stage where you know is just absolutely legendary, like has been around for decades and decades and decades and has had so many just incredible like artists. It's really a feeling like no other. Even like we always get worried about how many people are going to be at our shows. If I was playing to no one on that stage, I wouldn't care, because you're playing the Stone Pony. Like,
it's unbelievable. And yeah, I mean, Bruce Springsteen, I mean, I couldn't even do the whole list, but obviously the East Street Band was there, Southside Johnny. I heard Scott Engel and the Smoking Jackets have played there.
It's crazy. And I remember that show that past photo was from. Our first time we played there, I remember a few minutes before we went on, we were just looking at the wall and looking at all the pictures with the signatures, the guitars with the signatures, just of everyone who has played there. There's a picture of Courtney Love from when Hole played there, which we didn't even know that Hole played there.
I didn't know that.
And in our set, we cover two Hole songs. Like, it's very obvious we're heavily inspired by them. And one of my favorite bands of all time. And I remember there's a photo, I wish I had sent it, but there's a photo of me and Aaron, our singer, we're like doing this, like to the picture of them.
Oh, I love that. Wall, yeah.
It's cute. And it's just, it's so crazy just to think of all the people that have been on that stage before that you get to go on. It's really just a feeling like no other.
Well, you know what? You're going to send us that picture. And we'll and through the magic of editing, not now, yeah. but after the show, but through the magic of editing, Scott will, it'll appear on our show. So we'll get that on. And I think now is a good time. Just a little clip. We have a little clip of you guys playing here. So we'll just put that on. What a great clip. And I got to say, like, when I went to see you guys, that clip is so sort of consistent with what I saw, which was, you know, rock and rollers loving what they're doing, being them. I mean, you guys were just, I could tell. You could tell when you see a band and they're not, you know, they're trying to be something they're not, or they're worried about things like that. You guys were just so true to what you were doing. And a lot of songs with a lot of great hooks. That song is really catchy. Like, now it's going to be stuck in my head for the rest of tonight. Mm-hmm. But it's a great tune. So let's talk a little bit about the band. Girlbossanova. How did you come up with that name? Or how did someone come up with
it? So our singer, it was all Erin. She's a genius when it comes to, like, wordplay, stuff like that. I wish I knew how she came up with it. But I guess the context for that is there's the whole, I don't even know what to call it, just like internet thing of like the girl boss. Like,
okay. Just, so that's a thing.
It's a thing. I wouldn't really know how to describe it. And I'm scared to describe it wrong because that would be embarrassing. But I guess it's just like it's something that started out in full seriousness, like, oh, like girl boss, like a girl in, I guess, your a bosses. Position that okay. maybe and bosses, I don't know. And it started out serious, like calling someone a girl boss means like you're doing something, fighting the patriarchy in a way. Just that has to do with that. Like, you're just
that makes
a
sense.
Girl boss.
Right.
I don't really know how to describe it.
But. Yeah, because, you know, it's time, you know, my gender has unfairly had the steering wheel a little bit too long. And you guys are saying we want to grab that steering wheel too, right?
Yeah. So the there's that. And then life, obviously, Bossanova is a style of jazz. So we just figured put them together. And the band name, actually, it's kind of a joke, but I don't really, it's a joke, I guess, to us.
Right.
Because to everybody else, I don't really know if they pick up on, I guess, like the irony part of it.
Right.
Just because, but it all kind of goes into, and I might not be making so much sense here, but it kind of goes into this idea of like hyper femininity when it comes to music, because
that makes sense.
At first you have the obvious issue of males dominating the music scene, especially rock, and just just a complete lack of representation when it comes to rock music. I mean, you look back. I think one of the, and I might not be that knowledgeable about rock artists, like of classic rock and stuff. But one of my inspirations, I've always loved Heart,
right,
with Nancy and Ann Wilson. You got that. I can't really think of many more. I mean, Blondie, Joan Jett, you have artists like that. But when you think of that compared to all the male counterparts and all the representation there, I mean, you think of...
Oh, it's unbelievable.
If you ask anybody, just ask a random person on the street, hey, name the top five influential guitar players, well, top 10 influential guitar players, like, and you think they probably won't put a woman's name in there. And it's just, there's just a total lack of representation. So then you have like the idea of really wanting to fight that, and feeling like you need to fit into this box, I guess, that was like created like males and everything, and you don't want to be feminine, you want to hide that because, oh, I only need to play hard rock music and I need to be a very good technical player to prove myself and prove that girls can do it and all that.
But you don't want to walk away and from then, that, which is feminine also, right?
Exactly. So then you kind of have this weird conflict between like wanting to prove yourself, but then also feeling like you don't need to. But then you kind of just move towards this like acceptance phase, I guess, where you're like, you know, it really doesn't matter. I don't need to be the best guitar player out there because I don't need to put myself to anyone. And you sort of just accept like I can be feminine and still be a normal guitar player. Like, you don't need to do all this fighting and all this pushing. You kind of just need to exist and do whatever you want. And that's kind of where it all comes from, is this whole like acceptance of the whole like feminine thing. And that's kind of, I mean, that's very like a convoluted way of explaining the band name. But that's pretty much what it is. Like, and you see a lot of other punk bands doing it. Not that we're like a fully like, punk band, but there's so many bands out there.
You have a little bit of that. You do, in a very good way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot of other bands like accepting femininity and actually making it a part of their music, which I think is really cool. And because I definitely went through a long period of time where I wasn't accepting it. I wanted to push against it. I wanted to like be like, oh, I'm not feminine. I'm not going to like play up the whole girl thing because you're accepted by male musicians and there's no way to do that if you're feminine. And that's screwed up. And I kind of just moved way past that. To a point
we've made it tough, haven't we? Guys in general,
very tough.
Have made it difficult. Yeah. That's an interesting perspective. Yeah.
It really blows my mind how in a day and age that is so progressive, in so many ways, that is still an issue. And it comes up everywhere. I mean, we could be here for hours of me telling stories where we've experienced just being belittled, no matter how subtle or overt.
It's
happened to us just so many times.
As a band and as musicians?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Wow. And maybe, you know, maybe you're putting your finger on the way, you know, we talked about, will rock and roll maintain or might there actually be a resurgence? And if rock and roll is this, you know, sort of misogynistic, male dominated flavor of hard driving blues based music, maybe the next phase in rock and roll could be what you're talking about. You know,
yeah.
I mean, you know, I won't even talk about it, but I'm thinking about the Ted Nugent album that's in my garage back there and how, you know, to use today's terminology, it's toxic male. The entire album is toxic male. And, you know, I was this 15-year-old kid. I loved it because I bought into that crap. But you can do, you know, it's still rock and roll, but it's a different flavor. You're doing the blues based, but like you know, you're talking about, you know, girl power is even a slightly dated term already, but something that is not misogynistic, something that brings out the feminine in a way that is not the sort of style of feminine where men think that's weak, but it's simply that which you are, right? And, and that could be a different flavor of rock and roll, where you're not just retreading on, you know, on an old worn path that white dudes 50 years ago cleared out for you, but something different, something that's a little different. But with the guitar bass drum format, or two guitars bass drum format, whatever one decides to use, you can make it very different. And maybe that's a path. So that's pretty good stuff.
Yeah, very for sure. Yeah. I mean, there's definitely something to be said for wanting to invent it in a way. Right. Just, you know, the lack of representation, like I was talking about. It's like, there is representation. They're out there, like you think, like Sister Rosetta Thorpe, and like just legendary guitar players who are women. But then it's just like you look at what's in, what dominates it are male, that like driven, it's like misogynistic aspect, and it's not really something you can, I guess, continue. I think that needs to be reinvented, just because of how much it really dominates it. I mean, even some of my fans, like I'm a huge Van Halen fan, you know.
Yeah.
All those about women partying, this and that. And it's like, you want to be able to music, like do, but it's just, when you start thinking about it, you're like, wow, that's screwed up. Like,
I have a bunch of Van Halen lyrics swirling through my head right now, and I'm thinking, yeah. It's true. And and then, you know, we could attach to the videos, you know, that you know, the old videos of a lot of their songs, and it's exactly what you're talking about. And that's sort of the hard thing, I think, for anyone, but more importantly, not just a woman, but a woman in your generation who's like, all right, I don't have to accept my gender being in this role, but you have to find a way to, if you want to enjoy that music. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I would imagine a lot of those songs, when you actually let yourself think about the lyrics, it's cringeworthy, right?
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, same thing with like Zeppelin too. Like when they're talking about like 16-year-old girls, you're like, wow, this music lack, and it's also very disturbing towards women. So it's like,
well,
worse on a whole level, but you still want to enjoy the music, and it makes it difficult being like a fans like that, because it's just, they were so just derogatory and just all kinds of screwed up. They are the ones that's like the gods, like the legends of the genre. It's like,
they are.
Like when you look at that, it's like, wow, this genre does kind of really need to be reinvented. And I guess that's also a thing that really, really draws me towards like grunge of the 90s.
That doesn't have it really.
My favorite. It's completely gone. I mean,
yeah, you're right. I never thought of that.
Part of like the whole movement, a feminist movement in a way, because it's just so about not caring about standards and conformity and just existing as they are. And I mean, those of Kurt Cobain and just plenty of other people from the genre who are like feminists, like they did stand up for women's rights. It's a genre that has like grit, the same like dirt and like drive as traditional rock and roll. However, it doesn't have all the misogynistic aspects. And not only I love the music so much. It's just a plus that it's also such a good message in it. And a lot of what I stand for is in that music. So that's what I've been into as of my freshman year of college. So that'd be like 3 years now. I've been like super into it.
And you're a junior at age 20?
Yes.
Did you start early?
Yeah. No, I didn't start early. I'm also graduating early. I don't even know how I did it. I kind of just took the hardest classes way early on. And here I am.
Well, there you go. Here you are and there you go, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, by the way, I wanted to say one more thing about your band name that I couldn't go without mentioning. The fact that it's such an unconventional name leads people to talk about it. Like, mm-hmm. you probably get that question. If you had a conventional rock and roll name, you know, White Radish, I don't know why I came up with that. But if you can't, you get a couple of questions, but Girl Bossanova, it's even hard to say. I had to write it down so I wouldn't screw it up today on my little legal pad. I always like to show my legal pad on the show. What do you guys have coming up? What are the next projects? Are you recording? Do you have any good gigs coming up?
Yeah, so we have a ton of stuff we want to record over the summer. When I was home for spring break, me and Aaron just wrote a song. And so we have that. We have one of the songs that we play live, the song Sweet Sounds. We haven't recorded it officially yet. We have, like, I guess I would call it a demo out there on SoundCloud. But we want to record that song the way we do it now. So we wrote that song years and years ago. But we want to record that. We want to record the one we just wrote. And then we have like three other song ideas too we want to do. So we're writing music like crazy. And we really want to record that this summer. And then we have a ton of shows in May. We haven't booked any yet for June and July, but we're working on it. And we're just so excited to all be together and be playing shows and writing together, because I'm so happy and grateful this band is like finally like happening. Pretty new. We only started last summer.
Well, you guys sounded great. And I sensed that there was a nice connection among all of you when I was watching you play. I was watching the eye contact. Your rhythm section was really tight. The bass and drum.
Thank you.
Yeah, it sounded great. You sounded great. So as is always the case on Guitar Tales, the time flies. We've already hit roughly about 40 minutes, a little over 40 minutes. And I know you also have another engagement you have to get to relatively soon. So I wanted to thank you so much for joining us. And before we go, this is such a dumb question these days because it's easy, but I'll ask it anyway. How do people find you? How do they find your music on social media?
So our Instagram is just Girl Bossanova. Our Spotify, Girl Bossanova, Apple Music, same thing. Our Instagram, in the bio of our Instagram, we have like one of those link trees, and that just gives all the links to everything. Our YouTube is in there too. Our YouTube is also Girl Bossanova. Same with our TikTok. It's just Girl Bossanova. I don't really know if we have that many posts on there. Pretty much that's the name for everything, all the stuff.
That's great. And with such a unique name, there's no false hits for you, I suspect.
No. I remember checking to see if that name already existed for a band, and it's like, what was I expecting? No
one's gonna find not. Some there's not like a random pizza joint in Peoria that people will accidentally hit, you know. Girl Bossanova, they're only finding you guys. So Liz Roberts, thank you so much for joining us. We had a great time with you. Absolutely. And I'll be seeing you, I'm sure, I'll see your band at some point this summer. I live relatively local. And I want to thank all of you guys, our fans of Guitar Tales. We have more great stuff coming. Scott and I are really excited. We just have to put it on the books, but Scott and I are going to start doing mini shows within our regular shows. And if you hit us up on our Facebook page, on our Instagram, on our TikTok account, any of those things, give us ideas, give us topics for roundtable type shows. We'd love to do it. More great stuff coming here on Guitar Tales. Have a great night.
I'm number two. I'm number two. No, I was the second. That's right. I was the second one. The second on Guitar Tales, ladies and gentlemen. You're watching it right now. I'm Big Daddy Ed with the Amish Outlaws. I gotta go back to work. Here we go. Yeah. Tales Logic.
Hi, this is Dave Cohen, host of Guitar Tales, and
Scott Guitarmist of Dangle.
So we put together this show every week for you guys, or at least every other week. We want you to do two things for us, which would be good for everyone. If you could subscribe on our YouTube channel, that would be great. And
share. Please share the videos around with your friends. Let them know Guitar Tales is out there. It's not just about guitar players. We have a lot to offer.
Thank you.